What do you see?
One time when I was in second year of college, we used to do a class called Christian Ethics. And our professor was blind. He used to be called Professor Odur. He was blind. And one day, I don't know what we were discussing, and he looked, okay, he didn't really look at us, but he faced at our direction and told us, "You are very short-sighted." Praise the Lord. And he said, "Consider a blind man is telling you, you're very short-sighted." And you know, I thought to myself, and I said, there are people who have eyes and they don't see. Because eyes is just not just what you see, but it is in your mind what do you see. Praise the Lord. In your mind, what do you see? What do you see concerning your life? In your mind, what do you see concerning your ear? What do you see concerning your marriage? What do you see concerning your children? What do you see in your life? Praise the Lord. And today we're going to read, you know, you can't really talk about vision if you don't talk, if you don't open the book of Habakkuk. It says Habakkuk, Habakkuk, Habakkuk. You praise the Lord. It's in the Bible. Praise the Lord. Habakkuk chapter 2. It says, "I will stand my watch and set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say unto me and what I will answer when I am corrected. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time.
Amen.
But at the end it will speak and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it. Because it will surely come, it will not die. Behold the proud, his soul is not upright, but the just shall live by his faith." Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You see, one of the things I was thinking is that even before we talk about the vision, we have to learn about vision development.
Amen.
Praise God. Yes. Because without the development, the vision will not come. Amen.
Amen.
And we see the prophet says here, "I will stand my watch and I will set myself on the rampart." In other words, he's saying that I will pray. I will seek the Lord.
Amen.
And then he says, "I will watch to see what he will say to me." The Bible says in the book of Jeremiah, "Call unto me, and I will show you." Praise the Lord. You may not have a vision. And you may wonder, how come some people have vision, some people don't have vision? Maybe, praise the Lord, you have not called.
Yes.
Amen. Because the Bible says, "Call unto me, and I will show you things you do not know." Praise the Lord. You see, there are things we do not know that even if you Google them, praise the Lord, you can't find them in Google. You can't find them in Bing. You can't find them in any search engine. Praise the Lord. You have to seek.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. He says, "Call unto me and I will show you things." You know, God has a plan for our lives. Every one of us, God has a plan for your life. The Bible says in the book of Psalm chapter 139, he says that your thoughts towards me are many, praise the Lord. And on top of that, he has written them in a book. Praise God.
Amen.
Imagine, God has written you, your life in a book. And says, "Call unto me and I will show you." And many times when you read the Bible, you see, discover that when God was dealing with a prophet, he would take him somewhere and show him. The Bible says that when he took Ezekiel to the Valley of Dry Bones and said, look, what do you see? He says, can these bones live? Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Can these bones live? And you see, sometimes very many of us, we are very opinionated. Amen. Chances are you'd have told him, yeah, they cannot live. They are gone. Praise the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
But Ezekiel was a wise man. He said, only you know. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You see, and you see, sometimes you have to back off and let the Lord tell you.
Yes.
Because sometimes we tell God our ideas. You know, even when it comes to prayer, somebody, I had one person saying, it's interesting that one who doesn't know anything and one who knows everything, and the one who doesn't know anything talks all the time.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Doesn't even give a chance to the one who knows everything,
yes,
to say something. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You see, we need sometimes just to be quiet
before God.
Yes.
And say, Lord, speak up to me.
Amen.
And it's hard. Amen. It's hard. You may not make it for 5 minutes. Praise the Lord. But it's a practice.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. I want to challenge you to practice to be quiet before the Lord.
Amen.
A few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I won't tell you an hour. Praise the Lord. Maybe 3, 2 minutes, 5. Amen. Because the Lord has ways of speaking. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And sometimes he just shows you a picture.
Mm-hmm.
And in that picture, you will see a lot from the Lord. Praise the Lord. So he says, I will stand my watch and set myself on the ramp and watch to see what he will say to me. And I will answer when I'm corrected.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Then he says, then the Lord answered and said, write the vision and make it plain on the tablets. He says, first, you write it down. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know if you've written down something concerning your year, concerning your life, concerning your business. Amen. Concerning what you want to do. Praise the Lord. Have you written down your spiritual life? Do you have goals? Do you have a vision? Do you have a vision for your prayer life? Do you have a vision for your ministry as a minister of the gospel? You see, those of us who have a call, okay, we are all called, praise the Lord. But there are those who have a call and they know themselves, praise the Lord.
Amen.
Do you have a goal? Do you have something you are looking unto? The Bible says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Do you have a target? Praise the Lord. Because it says that, make it plain. Don't be complicated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes, have you ever gone to an organization and read their vision and you're trying to wrap your mind around it? You're like, oh, what are they saying? What really? Just make it plain. Make it simple. Make it simple. Like one of, maybe you can say, I desire, my vision is to pray an hour every day. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And I say, I will work towards that vision. That's simple. It's not that I will communicate with them. Just simple. Praise the Lord. Make it plain. And then it says, that he may run who reads it. Anytime you have a vision and you see it, it makes you work towards it. I was reading a book and they said, on top of your career goals and everything, always spend time towards your life goal. Not really your life goal, but your purpose. Because you may find that maybe you have a job But you know that that job is not my purpose. I have a purpose and I have a job. Praise the Lord. I will make a, I'll take an example. Maybe you are an engineer. Amen. But you know that God has called you in praise and worship. You know that, you know, you when you're drawing those engineering drawings, yes, you do it. But when you sing for the Lord, when you're pleading praise and worship, that is where you feel, oh my God, this is it. Do you know, when you know your life, the thing you love to do most, you can do it for free.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You, if you don't, you know, find out what is it I can do for free. Even if nobody pays me, I will still do it. That is an attachment to your God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Because I'm very sure many of you, if they stop paying you at your place of work, you don't show up there anymore. Praise God. The only reason you show up is because there's that check.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
You know, yeah. Oh, and some of you say, oh, I love my job. Let them stop paying me. Praise the Lord. You say, ah, you know what? The alarm rings, you just need to snooze. Bam! Get it. I've had it. Amen.
Amen.
It says, the fish, then it says, that he may run. Who reads it? You see, you have to have something that propels you to action. It propels you to do something. It motivates you, gives you an edge. Amen. And then it continues and says, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. Praise the Lord. It is not forever. It is for an appointed time. There's something you need to accomplish in an appointed time. And then you move on to other things. Praise the Lord. The Bible says it is good to understand the times and the seasons. Praise the Lord. You see, and you know, there's a day the children came here and they sang.
Amen.
And then when they sang, they filled the whole stage.
Amen.
And then we said, I kind of said in a joking way, oh, our future praise and worship team. And then I thought to myself, I hope later on as I was going home, I said, I hope I did not scare the present praise and worship team. Because then they wonder, am I trying to get rid of them? Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And then I thought, now if this is our future praise and worship team, then what is our current praise and worship? And I said, okay, maybe some of them will be pastors.
Wow.
Maybe some of them will be deacons. Praise the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Because even when you hear about some pastors and bishops and whatever, they tell you they were praise and worship leaders.
Yes.
So that tells you that something you may be doing now is for an appointed time.
Yes. Amen.
You're moving to something else.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Yes. That's why you do what you're doing with all your heart, because a time is coming that you will not be doing it. That you will find yourself doing something else. That's why Jesus says, while it is day, I have to work. For night is coming when no man can work.
Yes.
Yes.
A vision is for an appointed time. So at that appointed time, make the most.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We are here in this building for an appointed time. So we have to maximize here. Because we are going somewhere else and we can't come back here.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. You see, one of the things about life is that you can't go back.
Amen.
I can't go back to high school.
No.
Praise the Lord. Right now I understand physics and chemistry, but I can't go back. That time is gone.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I can't go. Okay. Now, don't follow me or quote me on this one. Praise the Lord. I can't go back to school. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Well, nobody can call me illiterate. My school days are over. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And you see, there was the time I had gone to school and had gone to school and had gone to school. I think I went to school for, I would say more than 22 years of schooling. Praise the Lord. When I graduated my final school, I said, this is it. Forget it. I'm done with school. Amen.
Amen.
Somebody told me to do a PhD. I said, no, I'm not doing no PhD. I'll do my PhD in Bible. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. I'll pull the heavens down. That's my PhD. Amen. But one of the things I discovered is that those seasons are over. And you see, one of the things I have learned is that even when you're a student, you had a vision. Some of you accomplished it, some of you didn't. Maybe you had a vision to get all A's. And probably you worked hard because you had that vision and got them. And maybe you had the vision, but you are not so motivated and never got them. Praise the Lord. I normally tell you about a friend of mine in high school. This guy knew mathematics. And you know, I found him when I was in, he was in Form 2 when I was in Form 1. He was good in maths, very good. I decided this is going to be my best friend.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You know, I'm always drawn to smart people. I don't know why, but when I hear somebody is smart, I'm drawn to them. So I said, this guy is my best friend.
Amen.
So I would go to their class and preps. I wouldn't book preps in my class. I used to book preps in their class. I just wanted to see him do those calculations. Every time I find a hard sum, I take to him. Then I found out this guy used to wake up at 4 a.m. to read.
Wow.
So I told them, okay, guys, when you wake up, wake me up. Praise God. And the first time they woke me up, I woke up, I went, I read with them. Half of the time I was asleep, half of the time I was reading. So we kind of did it for a while. Then it kind of got a hold of me. So this guy would wake me up. I would wake up, sit down on my bed. You see, he would just stop me and go. So me, I would sit up on my bed, I watch him. When he gets to the door, I go back to bed. Praise the Lord. And this happened for a whole time. Praise God. There are times I look back and say, I just wish I would have just been waking up. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
But you see, that was for an appointed time.
Wow. Praise God.
I cannot undo it.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. I can't undo it. That was done. And I thank God that was high school. Because there are so many mistakes you can do when you are that young.
Yes.
Can be fixed.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
So many mistakes you can do when you are in your 19s, in your 20s.
Right.
You can make a few,
right,
several mistakes that can be fixed.
Amen.
But now when you get to your 30s, now you start have you. There's no room to make many mistakes. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
When you get to your 40s and to your 50s, you better start stop making mistakes. Praise the Lord, because the time to repair the mistakes is not there.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So it says the vision is for an appointed time. But then it says, but in the end it shall speak and it will not lie.
Amen.
You see, when you have a vision, when you work towards it, In the end, it will show. It will show. And you and the people will be able to tell, yes, this person had a vision.
Praise God.
Because when you look at an athlete and you wonder, what drove you? Like, we just saw the other day Serena Williams. Is it, did she win her 23rd Grand Slam? And you're thinking, me, if I just won one.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
20 years later, we'll still be talking about that one Grand Slam that I won in 1982. Praise the Lord. You know, there are people who they did one thing. They just did one thing. And the rest of their life, they have dwelt on that one thing. But you discover in the world we are living it, you cannot live off one thing. You need to develop yourself and keep going higher and higher and higher. Praise the Lord. You cannot survive as a one-hit wonder. Praise God. And so as I was asking myself, what was motivating Serena? She has won and kept on winning, but she still goes back and goes and wins again. Praise the Lord. Well, and I said there's something she sees. Praise the Lord. There's a vision she has. And it motivates her, that wakes her up in the morning. Praise the Lord. Wakes her up and says, you know what, I have to go and practice again. And keep practicing, and keep practicing, and keep doing it till I become the best. And now, she's not competing against her opponents. She's competing against herself.
Wow, praise God.
Amen. Because as it stands, there's nobody who's done better than her in that field. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That means that you can become the best in your chosen field, in the chosen purpose that God has given you. But there is a timeline. There is a timeline. You see, that's the thing that we have to understand. Every vision has a timeline.
Wow.
Even me being a pastor in this church, there is a timeline. That means that everything that God has shown me in this church has to be accomplished within a particular timeline. Or it will be too late.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You see, there is, and you see, when you see a relay race and you start running, everybody runs and everybody has the appointed place where the baton is passed.
Amen.
And that is the most critical part of the race. You can run very fast, and just the recent Olympics, the American women's team, they were doing the 4x100 relays. And they had the strongest team. And as they were running, one of the ladies, as she was about to hand over the baton, the lady on the other lane kind of didn't really come out of her lane, but her arm kind of went over and she distracted this other lady so she could not pass the baton to this other. Now, thank God that they appealed and they were given a second chance. But sometimes there is a problem when we get to the place where we're supposed to hand over. Because maybe you haven't gotten to the level that you can hand over because you haven't run the race to completion. Amen. You see, each and every one of us, whatever we are doing, at some point will be handed over to somebody else. Moses handed over to Joshua. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Well, we don't know who Joshua handed over to. Those, you know, sometimes it gets lost in the crowd. Elijah handed over to
Elisha.
Well, Elisha had issues. Praise the Lord. Elisha was a very good prophet, but Elisha was something else. Elisha, I'm telling you, if Elisha was your pastor, you know what Elisha is your pastor. He was a very good prophet, but you don't want it. He will curse you. Praise the Lord. You know, Elijah was a father. Elisha, that's why Elisha did that. By the time Elisha died, by the way, Elisha was very bitter. One time, he was called to prophesy to the king, to King Ahab. Elisha came and he was very angry. Even he couldn't hear God. He said, I don't want to prophesy. Then he said, it's just because I respect Jehoshaphat.
Yes.
Then he tried to hear God. He couldn't hear God. He said, we need somebody to sing some music so that his spirit can be calmed. Because read the Bible cover to cover. There is no point a prophet needed music to prophesy.
Yes. Oh my.
It is only that time Elisha, because he was so angry he couldn't hear God, he had to get some music to, you know, music does something to your spirit.
Yes.
And that's how he could prophesy. You see, the time Gehazi went and lied to Naaman and got the gift, Elisha should have just forgiven him.
Yes.
But he looked at Gehazi and told him, the same leprosy that was in Naaman will be on you. But you see, one thing that happened, that Gehazi got healed eventually. Because when you read it further down, you discover, you see Gehazi in the king's court giving a report about the widow. Praise the Lord.
Praise
but anyway, that's about Elisha.
Hallelujah.
Now, it says that the vision, in the end, it will speak and it will not lie. Then it says, though it tarries. That's where the challenge is. That's where the challenge is. The waiting people. Though it tarries, that's where many people lose sight. Because as we said last week, our generation, we don't like to wait. Oh my God. Do you know, nowadays, even when I go to shopping with my wife, before we leave the house, I ask her, what are we going to buy? This and this and this. So I want to know the plan of action. Praise the Lord. So when we get to the store, I know what direction we are heading. Because I have learned, when I go shopping with my wife, we will visit every aisle. Every aisle. She'll be, oh, look at this. Oh, look at this. Hey, then you know sometimes I'm like, okay, do you want to buy it? No, I just want to see it. Okay, let's go to this other store. They're like, but we are supposed to go to see us. Yeah, we'll go, let's go. Let's first go to this store and this store. As if there are times we've gone to four stores.
It's not
the guy. And they're like, okay. Eventually, we end up with a store we are supposed to go to. Eventually, praise the Lord. So, like, on a Saturday, if my wife tells me we need to go shopping or something, I just decide, you know what, that Saturday, there's no other thing we are going to do. Let us just go and
shop.
Praise the Lord. We may not come out with bags. So it says, then, and thank God the malls have good chairs. Amen. Sometimes you just want to go sit in the one of those chairs and read your Bible. Amen. And they also have Starbucks coffee. Amen. So it says that though it tarries, wait for it. Wait for it. Because the Bible tells us about Saul. Saul, they were supposed to, they were about to go to war. And the prophet was late. Okay, he may not have been late, but he did not come in the time Saul expected him to come. Saul waited and waited. At some point he said, you know what? I've seen what these priests do. I can do it. He said, bring that calf, bring, and he did it, and he offered the sacrifice, everything. When the prophet came and found that Saul had done it, that was the day Saul was fired from his job. Because he overstepped his boundary. You see, Saul's purpose, he lost his purpose because of not waiting. Praise the Lord. The vision is for an appointed time. Though it tarries, wait for it. It says, wait for it. Don't give up. The Bible says, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? When Jesus comes, will he, when the Lord decides to visit you concerning your situation, will he find you waiting?
Wow.
Or will he find you already found other means of doing it? When God told Abraham, I'm going to give you a son. At some point, the wife told him, you see, God said he's going to give you a son. But I think what he meant was, you get the child through the servant. That's why we have all these travel bans and all this chaos going on. Because Abraham could not wait. Wait for it. Praise the Lord. Because it will surely, the Lord, the promise he has for you, it will surely come. Wait for it. Don't give up. Don't let go. Hold on to it. Hold, because it will surely come. The promise that God gave you. You see, God gives us, I'm sure every one of us, knowingly or unknowingly, there's a promise God has given you. Sometimes we don't know. We think it's just a desire we have. But it's a promise that God has given me. And one thing I learned that some, these things are God given is because I discovered sometimes when somebody tells you their desire, you wonder, wow, you mean you desire that? Then you're like, wow. And then when you tell the viewers, they look at you like, I. Because our desires are different. Like, let me give you. There are so many cars I see on the road that I wouldn't catch myself driving. And I wonder, you mean somebody loves this kind of car? Like, have you seen that there's a Honda that looks like a box, like a just like a square? There's also that Juke kind of car that just looks like a square. Somebody just walked into a car lot and passed every other good car and said, this is the one I want. You know, I look at the performance, like, wow, this is what you like. You know, our desires are different. Praise the Lord. We have different desires. Even when it comes to love. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
That's all I'm going to say. Amen. It's Valentine's, eh? Amen. So it says that wait for it, because it will not fail.
Amen.
You see, one of the things we have to learn about God is that God doesn't fail.
Amen.
He does not fail. His promise to you is sure. And that's why in prayer, when you pray, God reinforces what he told you.
Amen.
And when and sometimes one of the things you do is that when you pray and you start and you pray more, you discover God will start showing you pictures of things. And when God shows you things, hold on to them. Some of them may be unreal. They don't make sense. Hold on to them. Because just because you believed, you're able to get the prize. Praise the Lord. Because the Bible tells us of Abraham, they lived in tents. They said they were looking for a land whose maker is God. They went on and they were not satisfied with what they had. They kept on going. They kept on going. They kept on pushing because they knew there was a goal. There was something ahead, something better, something better. And one of the things I've discovered is that as much as even if we get everything in this world, we will still never be fulfilled until the day we meet Jesus.
Praise God.
Face to face. Praise the Lord. But as much as we are looking forward to going to heaven, praise the Lord. Have you ever read Revelation? And you see heaven. And you want to go the next flight. Because man, it says that just the floor is gold. You're walking on gold. When the Bible, in the book of Revelation chapter 5, when it describes the throne, the angels, the four living creatures, everything, you are like, I need, this is what I need to see. Praise the Lord. And the Bible says in the book of Isaiah chapter 6, it says, in the year Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. And the train of his robe filled the temple. He said, the moment he saw the Lord, he kind of discovered how unclean he was. He said, I am unclean, and I live among the poor of unclean. Then the Bible says, he stretched forth a call and touched his tongue and said, who will I send? Imagine, that God is connecting with you to accomplish things on this.
Yes.
That God. You see, sometimes we do not achieve or we do not go because we don't even know who has called us. We don't even have a vision of who God is. Because the minute we know who God is, the minute we understand who God is, then what he tells us to do, we will be able to do it, because we will know that we are not depending on our own strength, but we are depending on his own strength.
Wow.
We will not look at ourselves and say we are grasshoppers, because we will know that we are representing a mighty God.
Amen.
That's why Joshua and Caleb, said they were of a different spirit. But you notice that Joshua used to go to pray with Moses. The 40 days Moses was in the mountain, he was with Joshua. Funny enough, he wasn't with Aaron. He was with Joshua. I was thinking, that's where Aaron should have been. Instead, and you see, Aaron is Aaron needed Moses. Without Moses, Aaron was just any other guy. Aaron is already being appointed as a high priest up there.
Wow.
Down here, Aaron is building a calf. And he's telling the children of Israel, this is the God that delivered you from Egypt. And the people started worshiping him. And then when Moses came down, yes, Aaron, what did you do? Aaron said, we just put and it appeared. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
They're like, wow, this Aaron guy, the high priest, this is the high priest. It's not like some guy who was just picked from the street. It's the high priest himself. Then you're like, if Aaron had such issues and he was still God's high priest, thank God. Thank God. Amen.
Amen.
You know, sometimes you look at yourself and you say, my God, how can God use me? Just look at some of the guys God used. Just look at the Bible. Look at some of the people God has used. Crazy people. Some people, like David. You look at, you know, if you met somebody who has done the stuff David did, you don't even want to talk to them.
Yeah.
But that's the person God is saying, a man after my heart.
Hallelujah.
So don't disqualify yourself.
Amen.
For just, you know, some of you, maybe the thing is, maybe you talked bad about somebody and you think you're so good. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Maybe your problem is only beer. Liquid, just liquid getting in your body. That's your problem. And you think God cannot use you. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
God, somebody like Rahab, a prostitute.
Wow.
She had faith more than the Israelites.
Mm. Wow.
She said, we have heard about your God.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
And I want to make a covenant with you that when you come, do not destroy my family.
Yes.
I will help you. Mm. And don't forget.
Don't forget.
That at all, that only qualified her.
Mm.
That even she is in the lineage of Jesus.
Praise God.
Some of us, you don't even want, some of your relatives, you don't want them to be known. you say your cousin does drugs, and is associated with him. They do drugs, you don't want even to, your name near their name. Those are the people God loves.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Those are the people God brings close.
Mm.
Those are the people God uses.
Mm.
Amen.
Amen.
Don't ever think you are too bad for God.
Yes.
God has dealt with the crazies and has transformed them and used them for his glory.
Yes.
Yes.
But there's a timeline.
Mm.
Amen.
Mm.
So he says, behold, the proud, his soul is not upright, but the just shall live by faith.
Mm.
It takes faith to accomplish the vision.
Yes.
It takes faith. It is, because when God gives you a vision, he gives you something you cannot do by yourself.
Mm.
If whatever you have, you can do by yourself,
it's not a vision.
It's not from God.
Mm.
That's your own idea.
Mm.
When God gives you a vision, you will need people.
Mm.
So that means you need to work in love. You'll have to work on your character. You'll have to work on many things so that you can work with people.
Mm.
Praise the Lord. For example, where God is taking Sifa, I cannot be there.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I need you all And I did many, many, many more people. Praise the Lord. Because God does things for his own glory. Not for a man to receive glory. And now it takes faith to do what God has told you to do. Because God called Moses and he told Moses, this is the vision. The vision is to go free the Israelites and take them to a land flowing with milk and honey. Moses looked at God and said, God, I don't know if you've been reading current affairs, but I am a wanted man in Egypt. They're there, wanted, dead or alive. Moses. Impersonator. He claimed to be an Egyptian, yet he was an Israelite. A fraud, forward line. Praise the Lord. Murderer. Amen. He had all this $10,000 reward. Now imagine, the same guy, God is telling him, go back, not even to the boundary. Go to the palace.
Wow.
Imagine. But you see, God was with Moses. Because God told him, I will make you as God to Pharaoh.
Praise God.
Wow.
Think of God can transform you.
Yeah.
God can transform you. That those who are seeking to destroy you now are afraid of. He said, I will make you like God to Pharaoh. Because think about it. This guy caused so much trouble in Egypt with those 10 plagues. At no point did Pharaoh say, we need to kill this guy.
Yes.
This is the guy who's causing all this trouble. If we kill him, then everything will go south. But every time, he used to come and go. Now, the other point, he also has to deal with the Israelites.
Mm.
To the point that when they were in the wilderness, at some point he told God, God, I need to die today. I never gave birth to these people. But you're making me carry them. This burden is too heavy.
Mm.
Praise God. You see, when God gives you a vision, he has a plan and a purpose.
Yes.
One of the things he needs to know is, are you available? Can he get your attention? Because he had to get Moses' attention for him to go to the burning bush. Some of you, the bush has been burning for years and you've never been interested to look, why is this bush burning?
Oh my.
Some of you, you pass the bush every morning. And you never ask, why is this?
Don't even notice it.
Never notice. Praise God. Imagine. Probably Moses was not the first guy who the bush came to.
Yes.
But he's the only guy who responded to it.
That's true.
Mm. Amen.
Hallelujah.
When God bears his burning bush, please pay attention to it. Praise the Lord. The burning bush may become for prayer meeting.
Mm.
Amen.
That's true.
The burning bush may be something simple like one of the head of department saying, hey, we need some more ashes. Or hey, we need this or the other. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
The burning bush may be something that may look so insignificant.
Yes.
But that may be what propels you to what God wants to do in your life.
Wow.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So you have to pay attention to it. Amen.
Amen.
Because as we progress in life, when you look back, you don't want to be full of regrets.
Mm.
but you want to be full of. Thank God for what God has done. One of the things the Bible says in the book of Philippians, as I close, let's turn to Philippians chapter 3. Verse 12. It says, not that I have already obtained all this, already been made perfect, but I press on to take a hold of that which Christ took a hold of me. So we see that he has a goal, a target to be perfect. He has a target for what Christ has held for him. And he said, I have not obtained it yet, but I press on. I keep going. And you see, for him to say, I press on, it means that there's some resistance.
Right.
There's resistance for him to press. If I'm not pressing on right now. I'm just going. But if this is put, I'm pressing, praise the Lord, because there's some resistance.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And in life, there are things that resist you.
Mm-hmm.
Sleep may resist you to wake up to pray.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes not having enough time may resist you not to read your Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes not having enough time may resist you not to reach out to other people and even encourage them. Praise the Lord. Sometimes some battles within, like I was talking to somebody and I was encouraging them, and they told me that sometimes they feel insignificant. And I was telling them, why do you feel insignificant? You're not insignificant. And so the reason they feel insignificant is because probably they are comparing themselves with somebody else. And because they do not, according to them, they do not measure up to this other person, they think they are insignificant. Not knowing that person is running a different race. And this other person is running a different race. Praise the Lord. For example, I cannot be here trying to sing like Daniel. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Because that is his gift.
Amen.
So I can say, man, I'm gonna hit those notes. Yes. Amen. You see, and I will be so discouraged. Because I will think I'm not good enough. Because I cannot hit some notes that he's hitting. Praise the Lord. But you see, when you discover that God has graced somebody in a particular way, not to intimidate you.
That's right.
Yes.
But to make is a compliment of you.
Yes. Amen.
Every gift we have here is not to make anybody else feel less, but it is a compliment of one another.
Yes.
Even as musicians, every musician sounds different.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. Today, Grace is leading praise and worship. She sings very good, and we are blessed. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Sometimes, McGillian's praise and worship, she sounds different from Grace, but we are also blessed. Praise the Lord. Because everyone is gifted differently. Amen. Pastor Tina doesn't preach the way I preach. And I don't preach the way Pastor Tina preaches. Because we are, even in preaching, we are different. And you cannot try to be like somebody else. Because you will always find like you're short. You're running short of something. Praise the Lord.
Because have you ever listened to a preacher and you thought, my God, that is the best message I've ever heard. I don't think anybody else can top that one. Then 2 days later, you're listening to another preacher. You already forgot about the best message you ever had. You forget it. You're even listening to another. I discovered that, you know, there are times you listen to a preacher and you're like, you know what, I'm going to quit this preaching job. Amen. Now this, you know, but you discover that it is, there is a grace that
that's
God
true.
Has given each and every one of us for the appointed time. And don't let anybody's grace intimidate you to serve God. Amen. When you're serving God, it is to God. If you read the Bible, Elisha was not Elijah. Moses is not Nathan. Samuel, they are all different. And they operated differently. But they all accomplished God's purpose. So he says, I run. I press on towards the mark that Christ has given. Held for me. Then he says, one thing I do, forgetting what is behind, I go towards. You see, we have to forget behind. Even when you are driving, it's the small mirrors that show you behind, but the bigger shows you ahead. You can't drive forward looking backward. You have to look ahead. Some of us, we are always looking at our past. Oh, you remember those days we used to. Oh, you remember those days we used to. Forget those days. Press on. Oh, those days we used to pray. Hey, don't tell me that. Pray now. Amen.
Amen.
Why do you remember those days? Pray now.
Amen.
Those days I used to remember. Those days I never used to miss any fellowship. Those days I never, no. Do it today.
Amen.
While it is today, let us serve the Lord.
Yes.
While it is today, let us be our best.
Yes.
Let never, don't ever look at your past being better than your present.
Yes.
Because we are supposed to progress, not to depreciate. We are supposed to always go forward, higher. That means that last week I had a very good week. This week I'll have a better.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That makes me excited about the week. Last year was good. This year will be better. Even in your career, in your finances, in every area of your life,
yes.
Look to better days. Look to being better. The Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes, do not be saying, why were the past days better than the present days? He says, it is not wise to talk like that. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We serve a today God.
Yes.
And faith is now.
Amen.
Now faith is.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So, resolve within yourself that I will be the best me I can be today.
Mm.
I will pray my best prayer today. I will have my best thoughts today. I will encourage myself the best today.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
And you will see God lifting you from one level of glory to another. All for his glory and his honor.
Amen.
Have a picture of a better you.
Yes.
Have a picture of a better Sifa. Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen.
One time, some people were working, building, they were building a temple, or rather a chapel. And one was approached and was asked, what are you doing? He said, I'm laying bricks on this line.
I'm laying bricks on this line. Say, oh, okay. So what do you do? I lay bricks on this line every day. Every day, I lay bricks on this line. He said, oh, wow, wow, good. Say, that's why I come every day, because I lay bricks on this line. Then they approached a second person. He said, what are you doing? He was doing the same job. He told him, I'm building this temple. He says, this is where the bell will be. This is where this will be. This guy had a picture of the whole thing. And he was excited that he was part of a big thing. Praise the Lord. Sometimes we focus on our task and we forget to see the big picture. Let us not only look at our task, but let us look at the big picture surrounding the task. Because something little you do pushes a lot forward. Because without that line, the chapel would have been completed. But this guy, unaware of what he was doing, he just thought that's all he does. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's rise up.